to our sixth week of Impact, Harrison Presbyterian Sunday School for middle school through young adult. Let's get started with our finale of the detergent.
You are the detergent.
You gotta learn how to trust your clique.
Guess this means you aren't the detergent.
Who is this girl? And why won't she live by our rules?
Because I don't want to.
Oh, she's good.
I never thought of it like that.
Hold still, so I can give you our do whatever we say serum.
No, I'm the detergent.
Hey, could you wash my socks?
Not that kind of detergent.
Is now a good time to take off my shirt?
No.
Whoa, that ended somewhat abruptly. But the idea of the detergent is to ask questions, evaluate the information that you have. You know, you need to figure out what you believe and then act on those beliefs. So let's see what Anna Maria has to say about acting on what she believes in.
Well, my dad would leave a lot. He was never really there all the time. And once my sister died, he promised that he would never leave again. And then right before her funeral, he left again. And I haven't seen him since. Our house got black mold in it, and me and my siblings started getting really sick. And then we ended up living with another family. God just placed it where the family we lived with, he was kind of like our dad, I guess. And he would just like teach us things and work on our homework with us. And the church started working on our house, and they were working on things and like changing the windows and like putting in a new sink. Through the church family showing love, even though they didn't know everything about me, it just showed me that I can do the same thing and that God has a plan. And whether or not you think you're part of it, you are. That's whenever we started to take people to church. It started just a Wednesday, and I was just going to church, and they're like, "Hey, where are you going?" And I was like, "I'm going to church." And so her and my other friend, they started coming, and that happened for like a month. And then other people would just like started coming with us. People would be like, "Oh, I want to come." And I'd be like, "Okay." So like our 15 passenger van ended up, like after a year and a half, taking like 100 and something kids. My pastor started asking me like, "Who are all these people coming with you?" And I was like, "To be honest, I don't know." They just kind of go to school with me. And like I would just go around school and like talk about God all the time. Like I was the Bible girl. And I just decided to invite them, and surprisingly enough, they wanted to come. Some people who started coming with us were a little antsy about it at first, because they would smoke and drink and party, and some were pregnant and some had already had children, and they just didn't really know what to do. But some people stopped doing drugs and stopped like doing things they know they shouldn't have been doing, because now they had people that loved them and they held them accountable for what they were doing. And you learn to love other people more, because you realize that life is really hard, but there's other people that are going through the same thing as you. Now it was just like a normal thing for them to walk around and talk about what we learned at church. Even the teachers at school would tell me like, "Thank you for taking them. I've seen such an improvement in like their grades, and like, thank you for loving them." Like 5 to 10 people decided to give their life to God, and there was a lot of people that ended up coming and learning so much and like getting baptized. And even if their families didn't approve, they knew that I was here and my mom was here and all of our brothers and sisters in Christ, like we were all there to encourage them and let them know that we were proud of them. Taking people to church and having another family that calls my mom and me their sister, that is what encourages me.
Anna Maria's story was really touching. She had a father that was leaving, and a sister that died, and the black mold that got into their household, but God brought them to a family that was supportive. And what a ministry she ended up having, because God ended up giving her the boldness to really reach out to people that she might not even know all that well, just like the people in her church did for her family. So what a wonderful ministry that she started just by inviting one or two people, and then it just kind of snowballed into a great just discipleship of people that she barely even knew. But she was able to show God's love and compassion and just acceptance to people from all different backgrounds. Let's see what Pastor Mason has to say.
Being a disciple, you probably hear that term a lot, and discipleship is at the core of our identity as believers. It's so much so that this is an ancient idea that goes all the way back to what God originally commissioned Adam and Eve to do. He told them, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth. It meant populate the earth with lookalikes of the living God. And that's what discipleship is. And the context of discipleship is Christian community. And that's why when Jesus left, one of the last things he left us with is go therefore in all the nations and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Everything in our life should be built around this idea of being a disciple. A disciple is a person that has renounced his or herself and become submitted in a lifetime apprenticeship to the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me say that again. A disciple is someone who has denounced his or herself and embrace the reality of being in a lifelong apprenticeship to Jesus Christ. So man, what an invitation Christ gives. Christ gives us the invitation, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I'm meek and lowly at heart, and you will find rest for your soul. Why? Because he sees people who are heavy laden and burdened and invites them, yo, come into a relationship with me, take my yoke upon you. It's the idea of an ox who back then they had a joint on their shoulders that's like a which is called a yoke. And it pulled and tilted the ground behind them. And it was very, very hard. And it was based on the strength of the type of ox. But many times they would put another little one behind the big one so that the big one could take most of the weight. And that's what Christ does. And we invite people to join us behind Jesus Christ. And you're not too young to do that now. You are able, even now at this season of your life as a believer, to be committed to the great goal of discipleship and going out and engaging lost people, engaging your friends in every sphere of influence that you're in with the goodness of the gospel of peace. And you can now be the one who said, I've made a decision to follow Jesus Christ. And now you can begin putting out the net for others to say, make a decision, come on into a relationship with God through Jesus Christ. But this is what the Bible is about. It's not just about conversions. The Bible is about disciple making. So we want to see people go from spiritual death to spiritual life, admonishing and teaching every man that they may be presented complete in Christ. So what we want to do is we want to see people go from spiritual death to spiritual life. Colossians 1, God has transferred us from the domain of darkness to the domain of his marvelous son. So we want to do that. But we also want to take people from spiritual infancy to spiritual maturity. And that means that we're being a part of the process of helping someone grow more and more and more and be conformed to the glorious image of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so that's when we admonish them. That's when we teach them in order that they may be presented complete in Christ and that we would as well. Paul was such a great disciple maker that when he led Titus, I believe, to Christ, discipled him from spiritual infancy to spiritual maturity, and Timothy as well. Titus in chapter 7 of 2 Corinthians, when Paul got depressed, came and counseled him. Can you believe that? He made a disciple so well that the guy who he led to Christ and discipled was able to counsel him who discipled him through a difficult time. Let's get out here on the grind of making disciples, which we've already, through Christ, been empowered to do. And can you imagine someone weeping if you're going off to college and saying, man, you were part of my journey, and the reason why I'm where I am is ultimately because of God, but you were the pipeline that God utilized to funnel the truth of the kingdom into my soul, and you were, and you did this, and the time that you did this for me, the time that you read this with me, the time that you prayed with me, the time that you just sat with me, all of those things help play a vital role in me becoming the believer that I am today. Let's make a decision to not be stagnant youth, which none of you, because of Christ, didn't save you to be stagnant. He saved you to be a beast for him. And so let's get up and let's get out and let's go make some disciples of all nations for the glory of God through Jesus Christ. Let's get it.
There were a few things that I wanted to point out from Pastor Mason's talk today that I thought were really important for us to touch upon again. The first was he had mentioned in Matthew 28:19, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And that's what we call the Great Commission. It was something that Jesus was commissioning or giving a job to the people that were following him, his disciples, but also to us. So we are being commissioned as Christians to go and make disciples. And what are disciples? As Pastor Mason had said, a disciple is someone who has denounced himself or herself and embraced a lifelong apprenticeship to Jesus. So what is an apprentice? And an apprentice is someone who is not at the top, doesn't know all the things that there are to know about a job, but someone that's willing to learn, someone that's willing to watch the leader and learn from the leader. And who is our leader? Jesus Christ. He was, he's God incarnate. He came to the earth and lived a perfect life. And in doing so, he showed us how to love and that he's got the power to heal and to give compassion. And he left us with the Holy Spirit, which gives us a boldness. And we know that God is present with us because his Spirit is with us all the time in the Holy Spirit. So I also wanted to point out in Matthew 11:29, Pastor Mason had mentioned that Jesus had said, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly of heart. You will find rest, and you will find rest for your soul. So Jesus did come as a meek and lowly. I mean, he was born in a stable. And when he was growing up, he grew in a family where the dad was a carpenter. But that's not just a lowly position in life, because some people might be very wealthy, or God is calling us to actually be lowly of heart, which is very different than just your stature in your community. Lowly of heart means being humble and being meek and being willing to say, I don't know it all, but I'm willing to learn, and willing to submit to when God tells us to do something, or when we feel God is calling us to say something to someone, such as to make disciples, we should do it. So God will give us the boldness and the words to say if we don't know what to say. And do you know any people that are burdened? Because I sure do, and I'm sure you know some people that are burdened and that can use some good news. So God can give them peace or hope, but how will they know about God and the hope that God gives unless we tell them? Go therefore and make disciples of all nations. Matthew 28:19. I'm so glad that you could join us again for Impact. This was our sixth week in the lesson series on decisions, which is the last week with Pastor Mason, where we were learning about the decision to follow Christ and the decision to grow in Christ. So our next lesson series will be with a different pastor, but we all have a lot to learn about the Bible and about growing in Christ. So I hope you can join us in the future. Please be praying for each other. I've been praying for the people that are watching these videos, but please be praying for each other as well, that our hearts will be open to the lessons that God has for us to learn. And please be also praying for your families and friends who may not know Christ, and that God will give you the boldness to make disciples and share the good news with them as well. I hope you all have a wonderful week. Bye-bye.